All right. Well, I am very pleased to be here. Thank you to the organizing committee. I'm pleased to be here to share with you some results on landscape permeability. I'm also really excited to be here to learn from you. So this is why I really like workshops is you get to share information, you get to learn, you get to discuss. So maybe there's not time to ask me questions or give me feedback directly after this. I'm around for the next 2 days, and so I appreciate the feedback the discussion. So, let's see. So what I'd like to do today is talk about landscape permeability mapping that I've recently completed, and as excited as I am here to be here right now, I was really excited, more excited, that the model actually ran on by Monday morning. Part of the thought here is, why do we need a big comprehensive landscape perspective? What does that do? And how do we go about doing that? So what is landscape permeability? And I just want to point out, as you can see on the right-hand side here, the vision of the GNLCC science document is really to support landscape integrity. And you see on the top there, maintain large intact landscapes, conserve landscape connectivity. So this is directly linked to those broad goals. And then of course, Tom mentioned earlier today that, what are the use of this and what's the scale of this? I'm pushing you to think big and broad and long term. Totally recognize that there are also local scale, more regional scale data that need to come into play here. We can talk about the interchange of those. So I also wanted to step back and really help try to motivate action and at least thought, but hopefully some action as well. So this is going back to a slide that Tom showed earlier, but this is for 1997, 15 years ago. So this is what the area looks like from as a sort of a rough surrogate of human modification there. And we can fast forward to 2012, and I'll just toggle back once more, 1997. 2012. And of course we see some things. We see some things that are not developing. It's a pretty intact area, particularly in the northern part of the GNLCC. We see a lot of change though too. And so part of the question is, okay, so in 15 years from today, where are we going to go? What are we going to do? What action are we going to do? I also wanted to bring climate change into this because I think it offers some unique challenges. It's a landscape stressor. It's not something out in the sky. It is changing things on the ground and how we need to interact and think about the world. So I like to use this example. So this is predictive vegetation biomes based on climate. Generally, the big blobs on the left-hand side of are different biome types. So this is 2000, 2030, some change. 2060, some change. I'll just go back and rerun that. 2030, 2060. So some dramatic change. We can talk about some of the details. What is that really like? What does it mean? The point here is that we need to be thinking at these big, broad scales. The landscape stressors that we all face and you all face as managers are operating at these big, broad scales, and long term. We need to be thinking, so what are we going to do in 15 years, 30 years, 60 years? That needs to be on our horizon. Okay, so enough of the sort of the context and the urgency. Let's get on with it. So this is the basis of the landscape permeability modeling. I'll touch a little bit and try and connect it with a great presentation that Tabitha talked about in terms of general modeling approaches, but I'll try to stay away from some of the technical details. I love to get technical, but I'll try to refrain from doing that, but come see me in the hallways later on. So basically, the main goal here is to talk about biomes here, break up the GNLCC into a couple sort of deep, unpack some of the complexity there using landscape integrity, and I'll show you a map of that here in a second. So using the degree of human modification to actually measure that, quantitatively measure that. I use a lot about multi-scale patching and I'll talk about that in a second. That relates to what are we trying to connect? It's important to know that. And then importantly, there are three main outputs of this approach that I call landscape permeability. So it provides a map of patch importance, corridors, which we've talked a lot about, and then these sort of, you know, lightning strike lines, centrality. And I'll describe what that means more specifically. So in any mantling process, this echoes a little bit of what Tabitha said. Purpose and target, you really need to be clear about what you're trying to connect. What is the species of the process? This is very much a structural landscape connectivity, maybe a little bit veering into the functional side because we're trying to look at biomes or habitats in general. We're using a resistance surface here is we're using the degree of human modification. So higher human modification, more resistance. The inference then is this generally applies to animal species and processes that are sensitive to humans. Okay, so that's the general inference. We also are identifying features to connect. Those are large natural areas. Okay, and we're doing that multi-scale. So some of the cautionary notes that Tabitha was talking about is we need to be very clear about what our assumptions are, what our thresholds are, what are those based on. What I'm trying to do in this approach is try to reduce as many of those. I'm trying to get away from making a lot of those broad assumptions. So my assumption is essentially bigger is better, larger is better, more natural is better. There's no threshold set, okay? It's a continuum, it's a gradient. And then we're producing connectivity and we're producing these three things. Typically what you see in corridor models and including many of the examples is how do I move from this patch to that patch, okay? And that's great, that's important information. I call those corridors. Also important is how important is that patch? How big is it? What's its context to the rest of all the other patches? Not just its adjacent patch, but what's the configuration of the broader landscape? That is not in most models. And most models also don't think about how to bring together a broad network. So that's what centrality is really used for. There are a whole variety of different techniques, least cost distance, least cost path, circuitscape, all those kinds of things. And I'm going to talk about trying to don't be isolated to one or the other. All of them have, they are all reasonable tools to use for different purposes. Depends upon what your context is, depends what your purpose is. So this is a map that recently built degree of human modification. So generally my approach is I try to measure things that we can measure relatively well. We can measure where humans are reasonably well compared to the vast uncertainty of climate change and where species are going to go, et cetera, how they're going to react. Are novel communities going to occur? Are communities going to decouple? And so everything that you know we base it on from today may change in the future. I'm trying to use a more cautionary approach. This is the degree of human modification. Green is relatively intact. Yellow is sort of moderately, so that's most of the cropland area. And red is more urban areas. I've built these models a variety of different ways for different areas. You have different data sets available to you in different places. For the transboundary study area, these are the data sets that are consistent. I'm shooting for consistent comprehensive because it matters when you do connectivity modeling across broad areas. There's nothing like a connectivity model to show you the boundaries of your data sets. I mean, I'll tell you lots of stories about that. So this is using land cover at a 250 meter, the biomes there, road footprint, so the tiger data and the Census Canada stats data. Accessibility through a road, so it's not just a presence of a road, it's approximately how heavily used is that road. Is that a big road and is it close to an urban area, a big urban area, or a small urban area? Is it further away? So it gets at this notion of accessibility. And then as a sort of a nod to resource extraction, which is one of those really hard to get footprint or stressor data is the night lights. I combine these in a very important way. I've written a couple papers on this, so I'll leave it to that. But you can't just throw these things together. You've got to have a good, rigorous model behind them. So identifying the features to connect, the bottom line here is we want to protect big natural areas and the corridors that connect that work. And so what I'm really relying on here is, you know, think back to the theory of island biogeography, some of our basic, you know, foundational principles underlying conservation biology and landscape ecology. Big, connected, things that are relatively close. And so I think of this this approach as sort of an update or a refinement of that in a variety of ways. Okay, so output, this is what it looks like. So this is the first sort of broad, complete perspective that's done in a consistent way. What I'm showing here is the patch importance. So this is from a patch-centric perspective, and these patches are made up for these different biomes that you see on the left hand here. So these five different biomes. The saturation of the color gets at the importance of it. So the darker, deeper hue of that means, yeah, this is more central. It's bigger and it's more central within the configuration. So don't confuse that with most other maps that are portrayed typically just sort of, you know, what is the local value here. So this is a really trying to bring in, it's a different view of connectivity, emphasizing what we're trying to connect. Then we can ask the question, well, okay, now let's emphasize what are those flow paths? What's the broader network? And so this is what is technically known as centrality. It's a network theory kind of concept. It basically, those bigger, fatter lines, deeper colors, show you where there's sort of more continuous, more flow, more, you can think of it as more individuals moving through those areas. So these are complementary to many of the other data layers, including CircuitScape, those kinds of things. So let's see. So again, I've broken it out for these different biomes. These, I believe, are mapped now, and they're hanging up on the wall, thanks to Matt and Meredith working hard last night. So just a quick note, we've emphasized in the cartography here the big broad extent so that you could see the big patterns here. Just to note that every single pixel on the map here has a network going down to it. So it's like thinking of capillaries going all the way down to that, getting detailed. So this is what the shrub and the grassland look like. Of course, they're different patterns. There's a different target there. We could think about potentially overlaying them if that made sense. We can think of overlaying this on top of our patch importance models. So what I want to do now is just give you just a little bit more sense of this. So this is zooming into the transboundary area just to take a look at it. So again, same color scheme. So these are the, you know, patch importance, if you will, and then we can overlay sort of demute the colors, demote the colors of the patches, and throw the centrality on top of that. So you can sort of see how they're moving through there. So this is a connected network where they're moving through those patches of habitat, more or less, which are, you know, defined by biomes, and then moving through that resistant surface. So how would a species, if it was in a particular location, a particular habitat patch, move across the landscape? And if you total all those individual movements up, this is, you know, an approximation of it. And you can see a variety of things. You can see multiple pathways. You can see multiple corridors. If we zoomed right in this, we could see where that line crosses a road. Might caution using that. There's an appropriate scale to be using these at. And there's also complementary information I'm not showing here is corridors, a very typical corridor look. But you can combine those three products in a consistent fashion. So this is what forest centrality looks like. Sometimes kind of busy, but that's okay because that, in a sense, reflects the whole variety of things. Sometimes there's diffuse movement and sort of a randomness to that. And so this shows that. So you can see both in places where there's a concentrated flow, perhaps, and also where there's diffuse lines, that's equally important information. It tells you different things, but equally important. And here's shrub centrality and grassland centrality, mostly just to identify it matters how you create these models and what your purpose is. So I'm going to quickly conclude here with just sort of a summary and I guess, how I would suggest you think about using these types of data. And so first of all, I think of this kind of approach as really pragmatic. It focuses on the effects of human modification because we can map that pretty darn well, and it informs management action. We can do a fair amount about modifying human action. We can protect it. We can change actions. There's a lot of other things in the world that we can't. We don't have much of a management handle, and we can do some things about human modification. So it's a useful connection there. I think of this kind of approach as being fairly robust. Okay, landscape permeability, because it looks at not just single pathways. It thinks of the world as a continuous gradient. It isn't a patch size is, you know, greater than 5,000 acres. Why? Because that links to wilderness area. Well, that's great. That's great. But for this context, we wanted to think about the biology and the ecology of this. Bigger is better. Presumably, there are more species. There are presumably more viable populations. There are a lot of things that links to. Scale. So this, again, I'm sort of trying to stand up here and say, think big. Think long term. So this provides a landscape context. You can and you should think about how to incorporate local and regional scale data into this. And we can do that sort of in an iterative fashion. So this is complementary. So this is this information, use this together with some of the single species approach data, some of the more localized data. They're going to be important to do both. This is really applies mostly to species and processes that are sensitive to human modification. I think that's important because those are the ones, frankly, that I'm concerned about. Those are the ones that are, you know, they're trending in perhaaps in a negative way. Okay, so just real quickly, wanted to acknowledge and thank the grateful funding. A number of us have been funded by NASA for a variety of years, including Tom Olaf for this Landscape and Climate Change Vulnerability Project. A lot of the work has been funded there, and a lot of the the thinking about how to present and what are the important questions have been driven by that group, and so I really appreciate that. Wilberforce Foundation to help fund some of this transboundary work. So really appreciate that.